Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me, yeah. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me.
Our story begins in 1935 in Charlottesville, Virginia. Jim Crow segregation in housing and employment is firmly entrenched. Charlottesville City directories from this era reveal the limited employment opportunities for people of color: domestic, laundress, cook, laborer, waiter. What they all have in common? Long hours for low pay.
Most domestic workers, those that might be considered industrious and ambitious, worked 7 days a week, off on Thursday half a day, off on Sunday half a day. And my mother was among those until she felt more independent to refuse to work on Sunday at all. And as I mentioned, the salary averaged from $7 to $10 a week. And it's under those circumstances that we see, even in this period of time, how blacks are treated on jobs where there's just about no future. That applies to domestic work in people's homes, to working for the University of Virginia. We surely have people at the University of Virginia working just about in the same position for 30, 40, and a few 50 years.
And to make matters worse, Charlottesville was in the grip of the Great Depression. Many in the African American community had lost their livelihood, and children were suffering for it.
A little fella stood in the doorway of a cold house and gnawed on a piece of hard bread. He complained to his mother about being hungry and was joined by a mixed chorus of 6 or 7 other hungry voices. The frail mother uttered a low sigh and closed her tired eyes. 8 small children, husband dead, rented home, and there she was, sick abed. The above accounts may sound like trial leads for a novel of New York tenement life, but they appear in this week's issue as actual reports of true cases of unfortunate citizens right here in our community, in our race, and in our city.
These are the conditions that Daisy Green saw firsthand in her role as public health nurse to the black community and fueled her extraordinary effort to create a little school, a haven for the children of families in dire need.
One of the things about Barrett Daycare Center that is fascinating to me is the founder, Daisy Green. She was a public health nurse, and she was an advocate for all children, both educationally and physically. She was concerned about their health and their well-being, which is why she wanted to start the center. She was also very much into civil rights, and she had a mentor that she loved very much and saw as an ambassador for all things good, and that was Janie Porter Barrett, which is why she named the center Janie Porter Barrett Day Nursery. She followed her throughout her life, and was very much enamored with her. And when she decided to open the center, I don't think there was ever any question but what she would name it. And so we came to be Janie Porter Barrett Day Nursery.
Daisy Green's dream was realized in 1935 when WPA, Emergency Education Funds, became available for vocational training and childcare. That fall, Nurse Green opened the Janie Porter Barrett Nursery School at the former Zion Hall at the corner of 4th and Commerce in Vinegar Hill. In her own words, Virginia Carrington recalls those early days of the nursery.
Everything we had was donated. The tables, the chairs, the toys, nothing was new. We taught them to count. We used pennies or apples or even potatoes, whatever we had. We taught them manners and how to write their names. There wasn't much crying when their mothers left them because they knew they were going to get a good meal.
A crisis point hit in the early 1940s when Nurse Green moved to Newport News, and soon after, WPA funding was terminated nationwide. Once again, female leaders in the African American community stepped up. Atelia Love Jackson and Virginia Hardy Edwards formed an advisory council and enlisted the Charlottesville Interracial Commission to take up the cause to keep the nursery open. With the help of Dr. Frank Daniel, the chair of the commission and a civil rights champion, the nursery school was licensed and renamed Janie Porter Barrett Day Nursery, expanding its hours from 6 to 10 hours a day, 6 days a week. Local civic and social clubs rallied and contributed to the needs of the day nursery, but funding remained a critical challenge. As Providence would have it, in 1944, Community Chest, today's United Way, opened a chapter in Charlottesville and chose Janie Porter Barrett Day Nursery as one of 10 Red Feather agencies to fund. Shortly after, the nursery moved to a larger facility at 501 Commerce Street, enabling them to serve nearly twice as many children and to expand its services to include regular medical exams and immunizations.
I can recall some 70 years ago when I was entering Janie Porter Barrett for my beginning of my education going forward. I remember Miss Lyles greeting me at the door and receiving me with warmth and love and took me forward from there. It was what a steal or a bargain because the tuition was 25 cents a week. I know that because that was a coin that I held in my hand to give Miss Lyles every Monday. What a treat. At Janie Porter Barrett, my foundation was instilled. I was there for 3 years. And I enjoyed every moment.
It was for low-income children. My mother was a school teacher, but during that time, African-American school teachers made less than Euro school teachers in our community. So she needed it. My father was sick, and I'm just so glad I got to go.
It's been intergenerational. You have grandparents, great-grandparents who went there, who have those children there now. So it's been a tradition. Barrett is a tradition in this community, particularly in the African American community. So we see families who've gone through there and they want their children to continue to go there. So we want to keep that alive and well. We want to keep that tradition here.
The asset of Janie Porter Barrett School was that everyone who went there, when we went to Jefferson in the first grade, you could tell who had gone to Barrett School. Because we didn't cry when our parents left us the first day in the first grade. We were seasoned. We had already been doing this for 2 or 3 years, so we were ready for the first grade and to be left. I can remember I was from being in Miss Inge's first grade class, coming from Barrett. I stayed there 5 weeks, and Miss Inge said, "You know, much too much for the first grade." So I spent 5 weeks in the first grade, and I went to the second grade. All of that was because of the foundation that I had received in my 3 years at Barrett.
Barrett was just so central in our lives as we started out with our educational process. And so there were community people, neighborhood people. If I needed a ride, Mrs. Tyler was down the street. She could be called or we could go down and take a note to say. But I loved walking with the girls to get there. And we learned so much, and we learned how to get along. We had chores. I loved the chores. We had to help. We were helpers. You were taught empathy, caring. You were taught to nurture each other. We didn't have a lot of disruption between the children because they really taught and they modeled that. Our teachers were good models for those things that we learned.
In 1958, the United Way Givers Fund bought a house at 410 Ridge Street and offered the space rent-free to Janie Porter Barrett Day Nursery. The new location provided more flexibility with programming as well as a large outdoor play space, something Barrett had never had. The center has since been deeded to Barrett.
Barrett is a neighborhood center. It's a community center. It's something that we've been able to count on. And sometimes it's been very shaky, but it's always been there. And for parents, having that option, having a place to take your children where you know they're safe and cared for and educated, is very important. We have always served children who lived in close proximity to the center. It's always been, you know where you can go. You can walk to the center.
We chose Barrett after we looked at a whole bunch of other preschools. It just felt like more of a family environment. It's in a house. It was smaller. Classes were smaller. The teachers are just so caring and really love the kids and do such a good job. So it just felt like a good, safe place to send the children where they could just be kids. They had a big yard to play in. My son also made a really good friend named Tayshawn when he was there. He came back as soon as he started going there, and he would just talk about Tayshawn all the time. So I finally met Tayshawn's mother at the Thanksgiving dinner with the parents at Barrett, and I said, "Oh, you must be Tayshawn's mom," and she said, "Do you find dead worms in your dryer?" Because the boys, I guess, would go out every day and dig up worms in the yard, just line their pockets with worms, and it would go through the washer and dryer. But I actually just really loved that the teachers let the kids do that. They, you know, go out in the yard and play, and they watch them, but they let them be kids, and they let them dig up worms and make friends and do all those things that preschoolers do.
One of the great things about Barrett is that it has a lot of community support. There are a lot of people out there who know how wonderful it is, who know how much it means to the families of this community, who have supported it throughout the years and continue to support it. We don't have now the social conscience warriors that we used to have to fight for Barrett and be ambassadors and go out there and, you know, pound the streets and the pavement to get funds. So it is, whatever we get now is crucial to maintaining and sustaining the history of this community, the history of Barrett. And so I think that in any way that we can keep it alive and keep it thriving, we have a responsibility to do that because it is a community center. And I don't think you can say that about many of the centers in this area.
I think it's just such a great part of the community. It's been around for 80 years. Its mission is to provide good quality, affordable child care to working families, and that's what it's been doing for 80 years. It's one of the few really affordable places to send your kids to preschool, and we just felt so lucky to find it because it's not only affordable, it's really good care and a really good learning environment for the kids. So when I was asked to be on the board, I was just really pleased to continue to support Barrett because I think it's so important to the community.
I am very, very fortunate that my education began with JPP, Janet Porter Barrett, and it ended JPB at Jackson P. Burley. Whether it was a coincidence or it was just an act of fate, I credit it all with the very foundation that I got at Janet Porter Barrett Nursery School. What a great institution.